We have with us, I'm sure, no, sir needs no introduction, Mr. Aditya Sondhi. He is the additional advocate general of Karnataka, and he is also the alumnus of batch of 1998. You all must have also seen his photographs in media today as one of the star alumni. So I recently found out when he was in the slide and he was going to the magazine, oh, my photo is there. So, as a context, this is a series of talks in which we are inviting alumni and other people to give a bit more insight into the profession. So, they are not hardcore law, but they are more related to the profession. So, today, sir would be addressing us on how to work towards being a lawyer. The idea came from another address which sir took for Bishop Cotton Girls, in which sir had some sort of grudges with the National Law School Committee, how it's not preparing its students for the real political practice. So he thought, why might as well hear from sir itself what they want the students to do more in order to be ready for the practice when they go out from this institution. So thank you so much, sir, for agreeing for this talk, and please, thank you.
Thank you, Aman. Nice to be back. And could it get more generic than this? I already got flagged from guys saying what sort of topic is this, but you've got the context to it now, and I think what Aman had in mind was my rather public criticism of not just NLS but the NLU model, which I believe does not necessarily live up to what its original objective was. And therefore I'm going to try and talk to you a little bit about that and then take your comments and questions, and I hope there will be many. In fact, this India Today thing came as a surprise. I was on a flight yesterday back from Delhi and asked for a magazine on the flight. It said India's top colleges. Another dicey area to go into. Honestly, as I started flipping pages, I found the law school section, and then NLS, as is customary, was number one. Take it with a pinch of salt, though. And then I turned over and said, star alumni, they had your Rhodes Scholar from last year and myself. So I was saying something is seriously wrong somewhere. At least as far as my entry is concerned, I'm sure she deserves it. But having said that, if you read that article a little closely, I found something very incongruous in it. And that is that you had a Rhodes Scholar, and let's say I represent the tribe of practicing lawyers as your so-called star alumni. But if you look at the attributes on which NLS was rated as number one, they had nothing to really do with what the Rhodes Scholar is doing, and certainly nothing to do with what I'm doing. And those attributes were employability, placement, pay packages, and there was a large blurb there of how much somebody who graduates from National Law School typically makes, what does the high-end chap make, how everyone is recruited by the time they're in their fourth year, and so on. And there I found a tremendous disconnect. Because if you read that, it seems like you're reading a roster for the IIM, right? And nothing wrong with that. I mean, if National Law School has to be on par with IIM, fair play. But was that what we really set out to be? I thought the object was much, much sharper. It was supposed to, you know, Dr. Menon used to talk about social engineering and improving the quality of the bar, and some of us took that pretty seriously when he talked about those things. In fact, at an orientation. And that object now seems more to be, how do we make everyone employable before they graduate from National School? It's quite a paradigm shift in priority. And that's an institutional change, if you will, that's taken place over what, 20 odd years. I was graduate in 98, you're in 2017, so yeah, clean 19, 20 years. And therefore, when we talk about being a lawyer and my critique of how law schools don't, the NLUs don't necessarily prepare you for the real politic of practice, I'm not being accusatory. I'm really looking at what is your institutional reaction to the real world outside, what is your engagement with it, And why is it that you don't have that connect, in my humble opinion? I could be wrong. I'd be very happy to be corrected and be told that indeed you have that engagement, but I'm not convinced. And I can say that with a deal of certainty because I've had interns, I've had juniors, I have colleagues at the bar, there are seniors at the bar, and I don't think National Law School as an institution has discharged that mandate that its founders had in mind when it was commenced. And I know a bit about institutions and alumni because I've written two books on my old school. And what that did for me is it gave me an opportunity to look at how institutions define themselves through their alumni and vice versa, right? You look at any institution, public schools, law schools, whatever, you will find that there's a general pattern that follows. And that accurately defines what that institution's grain is all about. And it disappoints me to see that the NLUs have therefore not stood tall in that sense. And the question for you would be, I see that you're a mix of batches, but a question for you would be, what is that institutional therapy here that tends to draw you away from the real politic of practice? What is it that keeps you away from court, to put it simply? Right? I'm not here to make a sales pitch for litigation. I've stopped doing that actually quite some time back. But I certainly want to raise the question as to why is it that not just NLS Bangalore but NLUs across the board tend to shy away from engaging with court. What is it within the institution that does not encourage you to engage? I don't expect the student community itself to solve this issue by itself, right? There's every chance you're going to go with the flow, you're going to do what your seniors tell you, tradition if you will. But where is it systemically that the NLUs have not been able to absorb from the outside and also provide to the outside in terms of engagement with the court? I can answer it partly from my experience while I was here, and I think that has extrapolated itself over the years. I don't know how it was when Faiz was here, but certainly when I was here in the 90s, we were still figuring our USP out. We didn't really know what the NLS model is all about, and certainly a lot of my seniors pushed the envelope. They were picked up by firms pretty early. They were thorough professionals even before they had graduated, and that was great. That actually set the tone for corporate law practice, for law schools to be pushing the boundaries of good corporate practice. But when it came to actual practice and being in court, I think we were left somewhere in no man's land. There was no institutional support, if you will, to take us through. And that's certainly true of first generation lawyers like some of us are. It's not very difficult if you hail from a legal family, but then I think that family support itself usually carries you pretty far in many ways. But the kind of moral support that one would have wanted as a student here, as a first generation lawyer, was not there. And to make matters worse, there was a certain sort of phobia about being in court. I don't know if that's the case now. It may be a sophisticated phobia. You may be given some very compelling reasons as to why you should not be in court, even before you've spent a day as a practicing lawyer. I don't care how sophisticated it is. In fact, I was having a chat with a friend in Kosheesh just before I came here, and he told me in ancient Greece, there was an offense called sophistia, or something to that effect, which was basically, I mean, pardon my French, bullshitting about things you don't know anything about. Right? And it was a punishable offense. People who spoke with conviction about things they didn't believe in and didn't know were liable to be executed. I know it sounds very fascist, but the point is, there was a bit of that here. And we've been sophisticating it more and more as we've gone ahead. And that has now become the reality of a lot of NLUs, I'm afraid to say, as to why court should be shut out from your options, from your mind, even before you've dealt with it. And you'll be given a bunch of great reasons, slow mediocrity, corruption, casteism, delays, red tape, etc., etc. A bunch of half-truths. I'm not saying they're lies, but a bunch of half-truths, a bunch of negative half-truths, if you will. And what does that do to a young mind, right? It naturally keeps you away. And of course, the main reason I forgot, the money. How could I forget that? The number one top of the pops reason for, I think, NLU products, by and large, to stay away from court. Of course, I was very happy to chat with Ayush and Aman, and they told me that a lot of you are considering the UPSC soon after law school. And that's a very nice sea change, I think, that's taking place. My classmate Shrika was one of the earliest, probably the earliest, who wrote the UPSC, and he's gone places. And that's a nice line to take. But otherwise, I don't think over this period of 25 years or so, and NLS is seen as the trendsetter. Everyone else wants to be you, right? So if NLS Bangalore is allergic to court, so is everyone else. And that unfortunately remains, and that therefore is my defense of what I've been saying publicly, that the NLUs have not engaged sufficiently with the court. And that trend has to change. I was having a chat with your first years about a month ago, and I said, it's probably easier for me to convey this message to a first year than to a final year or a fourth year student, because many of you are already committed. But when you're committed, look, you're not committed for life. You're committed for a short term, let's say, and it's never too late for you to change track. But at least in the first years, I was able to say that, why don't you make a change of tradition? Why don't you take this as a test batch and say that this batch of whatever they will be, 2021 or whatever, is going to try and test this concept, are going to collectively try and engage with practice. And when I say engaging, I don't mean you take this solemn oath that I will stay in court all my life regardless of how things go and how I get kicked around. Of course not. It's a very porous system. There are people moving in and out of practice all the time. There are people from corporate law getting into litigation and vice versa, people getting into academics, people getting completely out of the law. This India Today article talked about people who are in hospitality and art, and why not? But in that process of coming to a decision, I find, and I'd be happy to be corrected from you, I find that generally, as far as the NLUs are concerned, there are these barriers very subtly built in at every stage to try and veer you in a different direction. It's not to say that the government law colleges, or the university law college, or other such law colleges have got the model perfectly right. But then it also begs the question that why is it that those institutions are better feeders to the system than the NLUs are? It's a key question for me. And that question is answered quite simply, because I've had a number of juniors and some excellent juniors from the government law schools. And the difference only is that I just find them to come to court with a much more open mind. That's it. There's nothing else. Of course, JLC Bombay has a tremendous regimen where people start sort of literally working with their seniors while they're in college, and that's a great head start to have. But it's not like the other law schools necessarily do that. But why is it that I find a sense of modesty there, a sense of openness? Why do I not find it from the NLU community? Why is that chip on the shoulder? Why are you deemed to be smarter than everyone else? And even if you are, fair play, you'll always find someone smarter than you. And it's not about going out there and proving your intelligence. I mean, court is more real than that. You're doing cases, you're representing people, you're arguing causes. You're not just mooting, right? It's not just grandstanding. And that, I think, is the difference, that certain an open flow, saying, let's engage, let's figure it out. Let's see what the system's all about and make certain decisions. And that, I'm afraid, is lacking here. And you have to remember, when we're talking about being a lawyer, I mean, what are we talking about? We're talking about an asymmetrical system. Practice is not linear. Right? I was at the NGT yesterday to appear in this Velandur lake matter that you must have been reading about, the lake on fire. And there are many fires one has to put out dealing with these issues. I mean, for me, one of the great eye-openers has been being with the government. It's my first experience. I'm only a year into being the additional AG, and it's a compelling and a new experience for me. And I feel with 19 years of practice behind me, I feel there's just so much to learn and absorb. And it's because it's asymmetrical. Your experience dealing with the government will be diametrically different from your experiences on the private side. But this experience, at least as a lawyer at now what, 42, 18, 19 years out of NLS, I feel quite inadequate. I feel I haven't learned enough. I feel there's a hell of a lot more to do and experience. And that is the great charm of the law. And it makes me wonder, why are there not enough peers of mine, my juniors, my seniors in court? And it's not just a numbers game. I'm not even concerned about the three or four in every batch that go into practice. I'm talking about a deep quality of engagement. Just yesterday, in fact, I was reading a short story by U.R. Anantamurthy, which is translated from the Kannada. It's called Bara. So those who speak Kannada will know it means drought. And it was a story he wrote, which is set in Bidar, in North Karnataka, one of the driest and hottest places there is. Notoriously hot, farmer suicides, so on. And it's set there around the emergency. I'm only telling you this because that's another example of a non-linear, asymmetrical situation. And it's about a young IAS officer who's the DC of that district. He's a JNU product. He's a hardcore communist in his ideology. But he's in government. He's dealing with a district where Kannada is looked down upon, though it's in Karnataka. Urdu is spoken, so it has a sense of a sort of a Nawabi feel to it. He's dealing with capitalist India. His communist priorities make it difficult for him to adjust. To make matters worse, this is all, it's all fiction, but to make matters worse, there's a great friction between the CM and the MLA of the region, which comes in the way of them declaring it as a drought hit area. Then it's got a communal hotbed, and he has to deal with a situation where he has to give shoot at sight orders because communal violence flares up. And to make his life even more asymmetrical, his wife is having an affair with an Air Force officer. But that's besides the point. But what that book did for me is it actually gave me a feel of what you deal with in practice every day. You don't deal with black and white situations. You deal with multiple interests. You deal with moral versus ethical dilemmas. You deal with different pressures. And then you have the law. In fact, after the talk I did in the first year, a young girl came up to me and she said, sir, in court, do you really read and apply the law, or is it just practical? And when she said practical, she almost tried to suggest that there's no room for scholarship. What you guys do is push files, get some orders, you have no brains. I don't fault her for asking that question, because possibly that's the perception she's picked up here or wherever. To her, a black court advocate is some dumb bloke. He's out there doing something not too honorable. There's no jurisprudence there, there's no gravitas there. And then I had to tell her, I mean, it's very difficult to defend what you do, but I can assure you that practice can be cerebral. It's supposed to be inherently cerebral. Just because you're pragmatic, right? I mean, law is common sense in many ways. Let's not wish that away. But that doesn't dumb it down. The very notion of justice is law plus common sense, law plus empathy. Law by itself is dead letter. And law in application to real situations, non-linear situations, multiplying multiple interests. Look at the triple talaq case. How many issues and how many nuances are you dealing with? Especially if you go into the nitty-gritty of to what extent does judicial review lie vis-a-vis religious practices? It's a very difficult question to answer, let me assure you. And if those are the issues you're dealing with in court, you're dealing with real life situations, people's rights, many times people's lives, as you've seen in the Nirbhaya case, you have the capital punishment debate to deal with, you have an ideological issue that comes up from time to time, I think that's a great place to be in. And nothing just practical about it. Of course, there's the pressure of work. When you come to court, you realize that cases may not get the kind of depth and time that they deserve. I concede that. But why is that? That's a function of the sheer volume of cases that Indian courts deal with. And we can't wish that away. But I also think that that setup therefore creates a greater challenge for people to be more cerebral, more refined in your thinking, more pointed in your submissions. As a law student, if you read a brief, you may have multiple perspectives on it. You may have 20 points that you'd like to make. And you may wonder, why is it that the counsel in court is confining himself or herself to one? It's not because the counsel is daft, but because court is not a place to show off your intelligence. It's a place to get things done. And when you're in court and you're arguing before a court, the court also expects you to assist it based on what the, in any case, no matter how complex, there's always one central point, the pulse of the case. You put your finger on it, invariably it begins and ends there. And if you're able to do that as a counsel quickly and assist courts in making decisions faster, better, you're doing a hell of a job. You're part of justice delivery. Right? And when you're looking at it academically, you may not see it that way. But in court, you have a court full of lawyers, you have your colleagues waiting, you're blocking the queue. It's like an ATM. No one's happy being behind you, let me tell you. At least I'm always cursing when people are you're the next serial number and somebody takes 40 minutes and it then goes into the lunch break and you have to come back at 2:30 is the worst feeling ever. In your mind at 12:50, you're like, I'll finish by 1 and I can go home for lunch. No such luck sometimes. But I don't want to be flippant. What do judges see? I was doing an arbitration recently. I was arguing a matter before Justice Kumar, who retired as the senior most CUNY judge about 6 months ago. And we were arguing a fairly complex, non-compete sort of contractual dispute. And as he was hearing us, I was actually rushing through my submissions. Then he said, no, take it easy. This is the only case I have. And I told him, you're right. But in my mind, I'm still thinking of you sitting in court hall two with 60 matters on your board and 100 counsels waiting. And what does the judge see? He doesn't just see your case. Unfortunately, he has to manage his roster or her roster. He sees counsels waiting. Waiting is what? It's not just counsels waiting. There are counsels waiting for real people. Talking about being a real lawyer, that's what I mean. Waiting for real people, waiting for justice. Somebody's waiting for bail. Somebody's waiting for suspension of sentence. Somebody has a demolition issue. Somebody has a tax demand. Be that as it may. And that's the sort of thing judges deal with. And that's where they need this precision advocacy. And I would have thought, if that's the direction in which the Indian legal system is going, as much as there is structural change taking place, I don't see this magic wand that can suddenly do away with backlog. And if that is the reality of the Indian system that you're looking at, I thought there was great space there for idealistic, bright young minds, people who can come in and participate in that process of improving justice. That's probably what I mean by being a lawyer. And those do it. Empirically, they don't. Number-wise, though, we lost the race long ago. But I don't think it's a numbers game either. It's a quality issue. But then we have to ask the question, have we delivered? In that sense, have we delivered? When I say quality, I mean a standard of advocacy that brings to the table not just ingenuity and intelligence, but also an ethical style of practice. I'm not so sure the NLUs have done very well on that front also. I'm certainly not going to be saying too much more about it with the camera on. But you have to keep your eyes and wits about you. And there's a lot of sharp practices that are taking place in court. And some of them, I'm afraid to say, are taking place among our own community. I don't hesitate to say that. And is that the contribution? A lot of my friends from law school, juniors, seniors, come from legal families. I think for a lot of them, the default setting was join the bar. Fair play, nothing wrong in that. But otherwise, this open area, which I thought would have been magnified a great deal over a period of 25, 30 years, it was, after all, law school's a startup, it's an experiment. It's done extremely well. Everyone wants to come to NLS. India today says we're number one. And I am one of the star alumni. That should tell you how seriously skewed that article is. But therefore, let me end by simply saying that don't throw in the towel as yet. Don't form those prejudices that are easily formed as being part of the NLU system. See for yourself. As I said, it's not a sales pitch to come and practice at all. But it's certainly a pitch, it's a clarion call for this group of very competent young minds to engage with the system. See for yourself, figure it out. And see the larger picture. Don't just see it as, you know, that jolly LLB sort of microscopic view of what practice is. And actually, let me tell you, there's a scene in Jolly LLB 1, I didn't watch 2, but in 1, where they show this lawyer who locks his typewriter to his desk and goes home. Now you can laugh at it, but it's also very poignant that there are people who probably cannot afford a chamber who still use a typewriter, and they practice. God damn it, they practice there. And if they type out their bail petitions, have you ever tried to work on a typewriter? You know how difficult it is. There's no scope for you to edit. You can't cut and paste, there's no spell check. That's how pleadings were done. Obviously, at one point they were handwritten. But I haven't seen handwritten pleadings in my career, except for one 1962 suit, which is still pending in the Supreme Court. But it's one of its kind, let me assure you. It's probably the oldest. But otherwise, typewritten pleadings, you know how difficult it is? You want to make a minor correction to a draft, you have to do the whole damn thing again. It's not easy. But people slot. You see that and say, kya hai, back court hai, paan chaba raha hai, thuk raha hai, that's his standard. He's probably corrupt, he's probably a goon. And a lot of things the legal community has also done has not acquitted us very well as a profession. We've been violent at times. We've been disruptive at times. I concede all of that. I myself have had some crazy experiences in court during the Kaveri issue long ago. Some of my own colleagues almost assaulted me. I haven't forgotten those things. But it's fine. That's part of the game. That is not the system. That is not the default. So therefore, don't form these opinions vicariously, right? Don't just sit back, armchair it, zap channels, read critiques, and there are critiques aplenty, and then form those opinions. No, keep them in mind. I mean, a lot of them may be fair play. But at the end of the day, go out there if it means giving yourself a couple of years with an open mind. I would end by saying with an open mind, you'll do well. If you go to court looking for what's wrong, you'll very easily find it. I'll help you find it. Come. Every court hall and every nook and cranny, I will help you find something that's not right with the system. But that's not the point. The point is, are you bringing a burst of positive energy to the system? Are you trying to contribute? I like what Dravid said. Rahul said, when I retired from cricket, I always wanted to try and leave the game better than it was when I took to it. And it's a very pithy way of relating to a system. And therefore, do you, I don't think Rahul can say that the BCCI or world cricket is in a perfect place. But I like what he said, and that's a nice paradigm, I think, to conceptualize in your mind, to say, am I coming to a place, and by the end of it, am I leaving it slightly better than I found it? And that's something you should think about. Over to you.